I'm Chris Brooks from the University of Michigan. I'm a faculty member there. So I entered the field of learning analytics when I was a graduate student at the University of Saskatchewan in Canada. And it was in one of the most senior years of my graduate degree, my PhD in computer science. And the field was just starting at the time with the first conference. And what really drew me to it was the practical application. So when you go to the learning analytics conference, it's not just a bunch of computer scientists. It's not just a bunch of learning theorists or a bunch of cognitive scientists, but all of these roles are there. And what's really interesting is that then you actually have this administrative role that comes as well. At the time, that included provosts, deans, vice deans, and so forth, real change makers inside of institutions. And now the field of learning analytics has grown so that we have a K-12 space represented at the annual conference as well. And quite different than many of the other scholarly communities that I was publishing in at the time. And I saw the opportunity to really take my research and turn it into impact through this field. So I'm a computer scientist by background, and so I teach a lot in data science, and applied data science in particular, teaching people skills. I teach both online in massive open online courses, I teach online in our master's program, and I teach residentially in our undergraduate program. And many of those classes are similar in that I'm teaching people programming. With learning analytics, I can do a number of interesting things. So first, I'm able to look at students, individual students, as they're working in the environments that they would normally program in. For my case, that's the Jupyter Notebook. And I can start to see similarities between the different problems that they run into. And that helps me improve my feedback and give more timely feedback to students. Now, there's no turnkey solution for this, so a lot of that involves my own research as well and trying to build new mechanisms for understanding that and then wire up identification of student problems to the feedback loop that comes to them. So one of the places I teach are these massive open online courses, and it's a worldwide audience, and there's a lot of people that we don't know coming into that class. We don't know anything about them. We don't know their academic background, their achievement background, their motivations even. And so one of the problems that I attempted to solve with learning analytics was trying to understand from very early evidence, just the first week of their interactions with the course, are they going to be successful in this course? And if not, that gives me an opportunity to intervene, to send customized messages, to tell them about other people's success measures. And so this is an area inside of learning analytics called predictive modeling. Now, there's a lot of challenges that come with trying to solve this kind of problem. So one of the things that I got very good at was detecting which students would or would not be successful in the course. But one of the challenges was I'm working with third-party platforms. I can't always reach out to those students. I can't always interact with them. So one of the things that I really understood about learning analytics as I was coming through the and trying to use it in my teaching is it really requires this holistic approach. You have to have all of the pieces. So for instance, in a predictive modeling task like the one I was doing, you have to be able to not only predict, but you also have to have those mechanisms to be able to reach out. And then you need to have the pedagogy or the social science to understand what you actually should be engaging in, how you should actually be reaching out and nudging. So it's a sort of a lifelong a practice to try and do all of these things. And I've iterated in this in both the online courses and my residential courses. So a lot of the work I do is on predictive modeling and trying to understand student success and trying to do early detection of student success. Student success can mean many different things. It can mean predicting who's going to engage with other people. Are they going to get sociable with the class? Are they going to answer critical questions correctly? Are they going to get a certain grade point average? Or are they going to finish their degree? The promise of predictive modeling is to do that early and to do that quickly so that a teacher, an instructor, a pedagogue of some kind can intervene. And a lot of the work that we've done up until this point, or up until the early 2000s, looked at applying statistical methods to a class after the class had finished to try and learn things that we could change for the next class. predictive modeling really takes a page out of the book of Silicon Valley about continuous improvement and trying to understand, well, it's week one, who's unlikely to do well in this class or hit some measure of success, and then bubble that up to the pedagogue who can then make decisions and reorient the class or reach out to those students or support them in order to make them successful or help them be successful. And so really the goal of predictive modeling is to help students become more successful, but predictive modeling is really only one piece. And we forget that the predictive model is just that detection piece and that we have to add to that the pedagogy or the intervention piece. There's a lot of different barriers to learning analytics and getting adoption of different mechanisms of learning analytics, predictive modeling being one of those. One of the big ones comes in creating a data culture, a culture where we accept that it's important to collect this data and that we value and cherish the data and that we use the data responsibly. And responsible use of data is interesting. A lot of people seem to think that that means we just lock the data up and we prevent people from using it, but we should be looking at this data more like their buildings. They're part of our infrastructure and we have a stewardship requirement. And that is, if you build a building and you leave that building empty, you're not stewarding the building and its resources well. And so we have to be leveraging this data to better understand teaching and learning and those social processes around that. And I think that as a field, there's been a lot of change over a decade and that we'll continue to see that change and that we'll continue to be able to articulate questions like privacy and agency along with issues like social responsibility, helping others and furthering the teaching and learning mission. So one of the challenges in learning analytics in K-12 especially is that nobody wants their child to become part of an experiment. But it's a lot of wrong thinking, I think, when we pull that out. Because if we want people to be better supported, we have to start thinking about experimenting, analyzing, and we have to have the right guardrails. We have to think about not just the opportunities for research and for understanding learning, but how we make sure that cohort that has an experiment running in their classroom isn't being disadvantaged in some way and is being supported. And we know how to do this. Psychologists have been doing this for 40, 50, 60 years. And so what we need to do is now bring those methods into education, not just the research methods, that's well known, but the practices in our K-12 schools. We've got to start thinking about our responsibility to other members of society. That includes the future children who will be coming into these classes and how we can create analytic environments that are respectful of them, but are powerful and helpful for them as well. So I think the big advice that I would give instructors who want to start using learning analytics in their courses, whether it be in K-12 or in higher education, is to have a curiosity-driven mindset. Really think about what are the questions that you would like to answer. Don't have a data-driven mindset. Don't think about the data you already have. Think about the data that you might want to get in order to answer the audacious questions that you have. Now, you won't be able to do that for all those questions. There'll be lots of questions that the data streams don't exist. But asking those questions helps us articulate what kind of data streams we might need. And once you've done that, you really have something unique for researchers to partner with researchers. You have this question that they can start thinking about the methods, the sensors, the environments, the learning environments that they want to bring together, and the pedagogies in order to try and answer that question. And so I think that that's the most powerful thing an instructor can do, is really think of that broad question that you would like to answer with learning analytics, and then bring in data, tools, and technologies to try and think about how we would answer that. The field of learning analytics has exploded over a decade and has grown from, you take the Hallmark Conference, the Learning Analytics and Knowledge Conference, which was probably 40 people, single track, single room, to maybe it'll be 500 people this year. Very international, very diverse. So the field has grown rapidly and companies have rushed out all sorts of different products in the space of learning analytics. I think we've been able to skip a lot of the trough of disillusionment. There's so much potential, and we see it every day in data-driven culture around us, in lifestyle choices, in whether it be from entertainment to various other occupational analytics that have become powerful. There's just too much more opportunity, and we've skimmed, I think, that trough of disillusionment, and we're going towards a really interesting place with learning analytics, which is pervasiveness. And so once you have learning analytics in every learning environment, and there isn't a learning management system or a learning technology right now that doesn't prize and value the data that's being collected about students, about teachers, and about the learning process. Once we're there, we can start to refine and articulate, and we can start to connect those data sources together. And I think that we're at a really interesting time in learning analytics where we have all of these environments have data, and they will give us, whether we're institutions, teachers, or researchers, access to that data. What we need to consider is how are we going to bring that together to build holistic views of students. I think one of the spaces that learning analytics is heading in the next 5 years that I'm excited about is disciplinary learning analytics. So just like disciplinary scholarship of teaching and learning, there's going to be a lot more work that is focused within a very specific discipline. Now, I do data science, I teach data science, I teach programming. Actually, programming has a long history in the higher ed space of having disciplinary methods for that. But I think that now all of these environments are going to start to become more instrumented, and we'll be able to do learning analytics in those environments. So we're starting to see this rise actually in the health sector and teaching health, nursing, and that kind of whole gamut of health informatics. We're starting to see disciplinary contributions to learning analytics that come from the lens of health education. I think that's very exciting. And I expect we're going to see more in some of the other social sciences that maybe haven't had the instrumentation. I think law actually will be an interesting one, and business could be another interesting one. Places where there's been a fairly tight control of curriculum, of objectives, and of the learning experience, now with the technology that will have instrumentation, we have opportunity for unique methods that come out. One example might be, imagine a moot court where you have people practicing a jury a trial with a jury and so forth. Now imagine that's filled with sensors that are detecting a cadence of speech, that are detecting passion, that have cameras throughout and LIDAR detection throughout. What can you do with that kind of information? And I think we're going to, much of that isn't needed in my domain, in the domain of data science, but I think when you start to look at legal education, you might be able to find things there. We're finding the same thing in kinesthetic education, sports, for instance, as well. So I think the growth of learning analytics in the next 5 years, we'll see a lot of growth in disciplinary learning analytics approaches.